You know, I have to say that I do appreciate that bumper video, because how many of you, just by a show of hands, appreciate some of the men that were pictured that are your current Reform guys? Raise your hand, okay? John Piper, Tim Keller, Mark Driscoll, Matt Chandler. These guys are all in tremendous communicators of God's word. They are, as we've said many times, they're sort of the rock stars of the current generation. And well worth listening to. I do not discourage you from listening to them. Just tremendous communicators of God's words, and thankful for these guys. And they're not all, they don't all follow the same vein of Reformed theology. And this is one of my problems tonight. There's no way I can cover all the variants. You've got Reformed theology on this side, and if you have dispensational theology on this side, you have all kinds of different constructs under Reformed theology, as well as dispensational. You have progressive dispensationalists. You have sort of the revised dispensation. There's actually classic dispensationalists. That would be the Darby era. There is revised dispensationalists. That would be the Ryrie era. And then you have more progressive dispensationalism today. Blaise and Bach and these guys. And I'm not going to be able to differentiate all of those things tonight. I'm just going to be a little more general, if I can, just to kind of help you see the basic two streams of thoughts and some of the differences we would have. Now, I'm going to tell you this. The differences we have are significant differences. They're not salvific. In other words, they don't have anything to do with our salvation. And so that's why I encourage you to listen to these guys. They communicate the word of God and all that. But they are significant differences, and it's important that we understand them. And again, not every difference is going to connect to every guy you saw up there. Okay, so for instance, John Piper is a Baptist. All right, he's Reformed in his basic theology, but Tim Keller over here is a Presbyterian. He's Reformed, and they would have some differences within their belief system. And I'm not going to be able to clarify all that. We don't have anywhere near the time to do that tonight, okay? So I'm pretty sure most of you are going to be really disappointed, but oh well, okay? I'm going to do the best I can here, all right? There's a quote that I've given before that I love this quote. He was a Baptist preacher from the 18th century, Roland Hill. It just has such a sweetness about it, this quote. He said, I love it because it was said well over 100 years ago. He said, I do not wish the walls that separate believers to be destroyed, only lowered so that we may shake hands a little easier over the top of them. Now, I love that. That's biblical fellowship, whereby you recognize distinctions and you still can have fellowship within the framework of believers, right? You know, our own, you know, church and fellowship of churches has had historically a much more rigid kind of approach to who you can fellowship with. And to me, it's a very sad thing because because of the internet and because of just the media and the opportunities and the books and the way God has led and bringing out some of the great men that he's bringing today, individuals who might be dispensational in their thinking love some of these great theologians who are Reformed in their thinking. So anyway, just by way of introduction, Reformed or covenant theology and dispensational theology were both developed after the Reformation. Of course, Reformed theology very shortly thereafter. Both are orthodox, and by orthodox, when you say orthodox, we're talking about something that's right. Something orthodox is something that's right. Right believing, right teaching, right doctrine. So both are orthodox in their basic theology. Are you following me so far? On how to be saved. You know, it's through Christ alone, right? Both are evangelical. Though I would argue that the Reformed schools have not been as evangelical until more recently. Still following me here? Okay. I mean, they really, for the better part of a century, they were kind of dead in the water from an evangelistic perspective. But with the resurgence of Reformed theology has also come a resurgence for missions. John Piper wrote a book, Let the Nations Rejoice. I mean, he's all for spreading the gospel. But that was not really the, you wouldn't hear a lot of emphasis on missions 30 years ago. I'm just saying that. The two schools of thought have much more in common than they do not in common. Although that's not our purpose in talking about. We're talking about some differences here, all right? So let me just kind of give you a little rundown here. Reformed theology developed right out of the Reformation in the 16th and 17th centuries. Luther, Calvin, Knox, all pictured up here, by the way, I think. I don't think John Knox is, but at any rate, their primary emphasis, now this is important because this is going to kind of build on some of our differences. The primary emphasis in covenant or Reformed theology is justification by faith alone, okay? Remember Luther, you know, and the just shall live by faith, that freed him up, that started the Reformation, 1517, and sola fide, that is faith alone, and sola scriptura, that is the Bible alone. So those, there are other like sola, you know, grace alone and whatnot, but those two things particularly, faith and the scripture alone were the big things that they lifted up. Salvation, or thereby justification, and the Bible being our sole authority. Reformers were opposing the Roman Catholic Church. It's very important when you talk about distinctions between these two streams of theology that you understand the times in which they were born. Reformed theology is sort of frozen in time in some ways. I'll come back to that. But Reformed theology opposed the Roman Catholic Church. Things such as church government, the differences between the church and the state, and eschatology, that is the study of the future, the return of Christ. Those type of studies were not encouraged in the early days of the Reformation because those weren't the issues. That wasn't the issue they were debating with the Roman Catholic Church. The issue was, how does a person get their sins forgiven? How does a person get to heaven? What is the authority by which we believe? So you can see the issues were, it's not the sacraments, and it's not the tradition, it's faith in Christ alone, it's the Word of God alone. Okay, so those, you got to understand, this was the huge emphasis. That these other things were peripheral to a Reformed guy back in the 16th and 17th centuries. So just important for you to kind of get a grip on that. That's what I mean when I say the theology is sort of frozen in time. To this day, most classical Reformed churches, still baptize infants. Making those babies part of the covenant community. Now, let me tell you something. I've read all kinds of articles and listened to messages, and I have still to this day never heard a straight-faced message on infant baptism that makes any sense to me whatsoever. But part of it is because it's a hermeneutical thing. By that, I mean their understanding of the science of interpretation. They see circumcision of the Old Testament to parallel baptism in the New. Baptize babies. You make them part of the covenant. It doesn't save them. And so in that sense, they were the same as Catholicism. They still baptized babies. They just saw it differently. Catholicism saw this as efficacious. The baptism of a child put grace within that child. You know, Reformed churches don't believe that, never have, but they see it as making it part of the covenant community. There's sort of a protection going on there, whatever that means, and it doesn't save them. But I got to tell you, I pastored in a very, very strong Reformed community, classic Reformed community, for a dozen years. And I have to tell you that the confusion in those churches over salvation was rife. Absolutely rife. I literally sat down in a Sunday school setting one time with, we had some good friends that went to a Reformed church about 5 miles north of where I was pastoring. They loved coming. Their kids would come to our church. They'd come to our VBSs and blah, blah, blah. And so they come in for like we had some kind of a fellowship, and I was sitting with him and talking to him. And he said, I'll never forget, he goes, and he was one of the leaders in the church. He says, you know, we were having this discussion about the way you Baptists, how you Baptists emphasize that you have to be born again. And I said to him, I said, well, That's what Jesus said. He says, I know, but we were all talking about that here a couple weeks ago with, you know, with amongst the leadership. I don't think one of us has been born again. These were his words. So, and yet he would ascribe to the tenets of evangelical tenets. He would believe in the tulip that we talked about last week. It's very strange, very confusing to me. And infant baptism would be confusing, I would think. But once the Bible, remember, because of Luther and company, the Bible now gets into the hands of the people, and now they're really getting to take it and understand it and interpret it. And remember, the reformers did not intend, the original intent was not to leave the Catholic Church, but to reform it. It didn't happen. They, of course, you know, there was an actual split, but that was never Luther's original intent. But the Bible did get into the hands of people. Great men of God, theologians like Calvin. These guys were just giants in their minds and their ability to construct theological, you know, paradigms. And as a result of this, you know, people were saying, one of the followers of Luther was Huldrych Zwingli. Zwingli, through his study of Scripture, saw that the Lord's table was symbolic as we understand it. You know, nothing, you know, there's nothing in the elements that they don't change. Luther just slightly changed what the Catholics taught of transubstantiation, made it consubstantiation, and that is what Lutheran churches teach today. By the way, I know there are Lutheran churches out there that are preach the gospel. I get it. But yet, they wouldn't be Lutheran churches if they weren't holding on to their doctrine. And their doctrine teaches that, and you can read it in the Luther's Catechism, you can read it in the Augsburg Confession, it's right in there, it's what they ascribe to, they'll tell you they believe in these things, and it comes right out and says, baptism removes sin. That's what their doctrine says. I don't care what their preachers are saying. That's what their doctrine says. There's a church in Altoona that had a Bible-believing, gospel-preaching pastor. He left. And when he left, they got somebody else in there that went right back to the traditions and the doctrines of old. That wasn't in my notes. So Zwingli and Luther literally drew a line and a table in their debate, and there was a split then. You had followers of Zwingli, which is really where the Reformed Church sort of finds its moorings, and then you have the Anabaptist movement. They were called the radicals because they took it to a new level. Now they start to study and they're seeing things that just weren't real issues in those early days of the Reformation, such as the difference between the church and the state, such as individuals identifying with Christ in baptism, which should follow salvation. And this was radical. So the radicals, as they were called, or the Anabaptists, they were persecuted by the Catholics, by the Lutherans, and by the Reformers. Hated by everybody because they were so, well, radical. Anyway, back to the Reformed theology. It was in the Synod of Dort in 1619 where the tulip we talked about last week was actually developed. The total depravity of men, unconditional election, limited atonement, irresistible grace, and the perseverance of the saints. All powerful, biblical, and theological concepts of salvation. At any rate, a really significant point is, remember, Reformers did not, remember, they didn't want to separate from Roman Catholicism initially. That's why their points of difference with the Catholics on peripheral matters were not big deals to them. So, for instance, when it comes to the future, most classic reformers are amillennial. Now, that means something to some and nothing to others. Millennial means 1,000, so that's the negation there, okay? So no millennium. And maybe an easier way of looking at it is they would look at it as now millennium. That's the best way. So they would say there's no return of Jesus literally. Actually, the death and resurrection in the beginning of the church began the millennium. It's still going on. The 1,000 years is just a figure of speech for a long time. And so the church continues to grow. By the way, and I love these guys. I'm reading a book by Keller right now on reaching the culture. I love it. you will notice something so absent in their teaching and their preaching. It yells at me. It doesn't yell at a lot of people, but it yells at me. And you know what it is? The imminent return of Jesus Christ. You do not hear them preaching about the second coming of Christ. I mean, I'm speaking generally. Some of you go in there and dig, oh yeah, he back in 1988, I heard Piper. I'm talking about, it's just not normally in their preaching because it's not in their theology. They're amillennial. Classic reformers are, at least. And again, I am broad brushing this, so don't come to me with the three people that are not, that happen to be here, because I understand, okay, that there's differences here, all right? So at any rate, because they're amillennial and they don't see a literal return of Christ, there's a basic interpretive hermeneutical difference that we have with Reformed theology, which is how you interpret, particularly the Old Testament. In fact, Reformed theology tends to take the New Testament and superimpose it over the Old. Whereas dispensational theology tends to start in the Old and unfold it. It sees Revelation as progressive, as sort of unfolding. And in some ways, Reformed theology goes back in the Old Testament and tries to correct things. That's what it does. And so they would not see Israel, for instance, as having any future. They would see the church as having replaced Israel. All right, so, even though Paul says in 1 Corinthians 10:32, give no offense either to the Jew or to the Greek or to the church of God. He makes some clear distinctions there. And even though Jesus said, I will build my church, the church didn't exist previous to that. And I'm sure there's all kinds of ways to dance around it, but the truth of the matter is the church, as we understand it, did not exist in the Old Testament. They would say it did with Israel, and the church basically replaces Israel, which has some really powerful ramifications, even political ramifications, in our present day. Again, there are many covenant Reformed theologians who do believe that in a future Israel, so they kind of have a hybrid approach. They actually have read enough of the scripture, that is, they've studied enough, they see there's enough literalism with Israel that there is a future for Israel. John Piper would be one. He would see a future for Israel. I don't know how he figures it in, but he does. Reformed theology, soon became identified as covenant theology, because it organized its doctrine using the concept of covenant, particularly the covenant of grace, which sort of undergirds all the other covenants. And they would, Reformed theologians insist that there is really just one people of God. There's only one people of God. They would not make distinctions between, again, Israel and the church. That's why we it's often called replacement theology, okay? I'm going to read this little quote. This is pretty good. By downplaying differences in the various programs of God throughout history, covenant theology must attribute to Old Testament saints an advanced understanding of the gospel that rivals that of New Testament saints. So, for example, if an Old Testament exhortation says, bring a sacrifice into the temple, quote unquote, the meaning in this view is that there is a clear consciousness of Messiah as the coming Lamb of God. Historical progression in biblical revelation is not fully appreciated. Biblical texts are interpreted theologically rather than placed in their historical context. The method of interpretation finds itself unable to distinguish between the features of the Old Testament saints' walk with God and the New Testament saints' walk with Him. And features unique to the church age are left unappreciated, unquote. Classic Reformed theologians would be preterist in their belief in the future. Preterism is the belief that the Book of Revelation is pretty much an impractical history book. It's inspired. It's the Word of God, but they would not see it as something worth studying, let alone preaching out of, because that the events of Revelation have already taken place. They took place at the time when Titus came in from Rome and destroyed Jerusalem, and all of those figures and symbols and cataclysmic stuff took place then. And so Revelation really is not practical for today. That's what a classic Reformed guy would think. That's why you don't hear a lot of emphasis on the future. So let me just sort of summarize this a little bit, because our time's going to be up here momentarily. Reformed theology is born out of the Reformation. The principal opponent is Roman Catholicism. The main emphasis, justification. Emphasis in theology was on covenants, viewing, you know, the elect as just one people of God in every generation. And while taking the Bible literally, they interpret much of the Old Testament allegorically or spiritually. Which is, I see that as a real problem personally. I see that as inconsistent. I'm going to interpret one thing literally and another thing allegorically. The Bible definitely has figures of speech, but they're pretty clear when there's figures of speech. So, I've heard it illustrated like this. If I went home tonight and my house was burnt down, I mean down to the ground, and I called my insurance agent and I said, "Hey, my house just burnt down." And he said, "Oh my goodness, I'm so sorry to hear that, Pat. Is everybody okay?" "Yeah, yeah." And nobody got hurt, did they? Nobody died? No, kids were all gone. Just the house. "Okay, well, that's good. Well, you know, hey, God bless you, Pat. You know, hope you can find some more money to build another house." "Well, yeah, but you're my insurance guy. That's the reason I'm calling. I've got insured. You know, I want my money back." "Well, no. When you got insurance on the house, we were talking about your children, your family, not your house." Now, you'd have a problem with that, wouldn't you? That's a little bit what Reformed theology does to the whole idea with the nation of Israel and the house of David and the future there. They just look at it as they spiritualize it. They don't see it as a literal thing. So anyway, again, this is oversimplification. I get it, so oh well. Israel has no future as the church has replaced it. So, by the way, that's the reason why your classic Reformed people would not see, they would not make a big deal with Israel. Why are we protecting Israel? What's the big deal with them? I mean, there's no promise to them. The land, and what there would not be a real emphasis there. And, you know, that might, you wouldn't see a lot of strong advocates for support your local Jew, you know. Because they're just, you know, there's no distinct, you know, it'd be the Galatians, 3:28 passage they would allude to. You know, there's neither Jew nor Greek, bond or free, all are one in Christ. And that's a true statement, amen? In this era, the church, as we see as a distinct era. So, generally amillennial or now millennial, you know, not seeing a literal kingdom. And again, they're preterists. They don't see the book of Revelation as something that is for today. So, dispensational theology is I think it was Mark Twain said, history is just one darn thing after another. Well, dispensational theology sees Revelation as sort of progressive, one thing kind of coming after another, okay? The word dispensationalism, it's a biblical word as well, but it means a house law, or rule of the house, so to speak. And we don't have time to chase all these things down. It really actually was born in the early 1800s, John Nelson Darby and the Brethren Movement. It was forward, you know, advanced by guys like D.L. Moody, the Niagara Bible Conference of the 1870s. And most of all, by the very first study Bible to ever come. What was the very, there's your little trivia question. What was the very first study Bible of all time? All right. C.I. Scofield. Anybody still have a 1909 or 1917 Scofield study Bible? All right. Some of you still do. God bless you for that. And, the thing about it, the idea is, the genius of this was Scofield took his understanding of dispensational theology and he imported it into the Bible. That is, he put notes in there. And nobody did that before then. You have your study Bible. Now, you know, have theology will travel. You know, you took your Bible with you wherever, and people read those notes. So they had a huge, huge impact on the last century. And and some of the guys like Lewis Sperry Chafer was also a huge proponent. He was a theologian. He was the founder of Dallas Seminary. And Chafer also developed an 8-volume systematic theology that really laid out dispensationalism as we would come to know it. And at any rate, it gave birth to thousands, literally thousands of movements and parachurches and churches and mission agencies. Out of that, really, in many ways, in large ways, out of that Scofield Study Bible. Amazing thing. So dispensationalism is a biblical system of theology that views the Word of God as unfolding, distinguishable economies, so to speak, in the outworking of divine purposes for the nation of Israel in a distinct and separate manner from his purpose for the church, okay? There are 7 dispensations that have been recognized by the classic dispensationalist. Innocence, that would be before the fall. Conscience, that would be from Adam to Noah. Government, that would be from Noah to the Tower of Babel. There'd be the dispensation of promise from Abraham to Moses, the dispensation of law from Moses to Christ, the dispensation of grace, the one that we're living in from Pentecost to the rapture, and then the dispensation of the millennium where Jesus returns for the second time, sets up his kingdom, his literal Revelation 20,000-year reign. Now, I'm kind of like John MacArthur in my, he describes himself, I'm not like John MacArthur, okay? I didn't mean it like that. I meant I believe like he does in this particular way. He describes himself as a leaky dispensationalist. And I kind of see myself in that regard as well. I mean, I've been doing this for 26 years, and I have never, ever, ever preached on the 7 dispensations. I never have. I don't see any mandate in Scripture to do that. And so I can see some of these dispensations. Some of them I'm looking at going, whatever, you know. But, you know, without question, you know, the classic dispensationalists, one of the problems is they put such a clear demarcation between the Old Testament and the New, and even things like the Sermon on the Mount, you know, where in Matthew 5-7, a classic dispensationalist would say that's got no bearing on us today. And I don't know about you, but that makes no sense to me. All Scripture is what? Profitable, right? It's all profitable. That makes no sense to me. And even before I studied these things, I remember being back in Bible college and hearing this and thinking, huh? That doesn't make any sense. Are there promises in the Old Testament for us today? Well, of course there are. And lots of them. But are there promises only intended for the nation of Israel as well? Yes, of course there are. So it's a little bit of both. And classic dispensationalism builds a chasm there. It's just kind of stupid in my opinion, but I don't see it in Scripture either. But here's something about dispensationalism does take hermeneutics, and it's very consistent in the sense of seeing the Bible interpreted literally from the beginning to the end. That's the reason why young earth creationists, that's only about 100 years old, right? I mean, the whole study of that and the popularity of it, especially over the last 50, 60 years, that's because of dispensationalism. That's brought back this, you know, literally interpreting Genesis 1 and 2, the 7, you know, those 6 days, the 6 literal days, versus seeing it as some kind of weird, you know, esoteric, whatever, you know, that. I mean, I've heard Tim Keller talk about his creation belief, and I go, I don't know where you're coming from on it. He sees it as a story, you know, almost like a parable. Well, then, so was Adam and Eve literal? Because they sure sound literal in the New Testament. So dispensationalism is, I think, honest Bible interpretation. I'm not talking classic. I'm just talking the general concept of dispensationalism interprets the Bible, sees it unfolding, interprets it literally across the board, old to new. And And so it viewing, listen, viewing hell as a literal place, rejecting evolution as unbiblical, seeing Israel as having yet a future, what to do with the book of Revelation are all struggles with Reformed theology. They really are. Now again, speaking generally, okay? What dispensationalists would see as a modern-day miracle, Reform students would say, I'm talking about the nation of Israel. That it would even, in 1948, becoming a nation, and you see Ezekiel chapter 36 through 38 sort of coming together. I do, anyway. But Reformed guys, because they just don't see that. And the reason has to do with hermeneutics. I've already mentioned that, science of interpretation. So in many ways, dispensationalists rose out of men asking questions, just asking questions. It sort of fits the unfolding thing. Because remember, I don't want to be too hard on Reformed theology, but in a real sense, it's sort of frozen in time. And so after the Bible is freed up and get into the hands of people, more studies are going on and more understanding of Scripture takes place, such as the difference between the church and the state, Israel and the church, the future, the return of Jesus. Now, I grant you, dispensationalists and the eschatology between classic dispensationalists like Clarence Larkin's charts, are you kidding me? Can anybody understand those charts? Does anybody know who Clarence Larkin is? I mean, he's like 180 years old. I don't know how old the guy is, but he wrote these, he's got these charts and he's got every little thing happening here. This is when the devil's going to get released and this is what's going to happen. And I get it because Reformed guys look at this and they caricature dispensation. They just mock us. And I get it, okay? Let's not get crazy about all the details. But I know this, the Bible teaches Jesus is coming again. And we are to live, and we don't want to give up that whole biblical concept of imminency. It is a literal motivation for holiness and godly living and living with expectation. And I don't see classic Reformed theology as having that. Remember when William Carey, who was a Reformed guy, the father of the modern missionary movement, he wanted to go and take the gospel to the heathen, and here this guy says, sit down, young man, if God wants to save the heathen, he'll do it without your help. That was sort of the mindset of that era that just didn't see the necessity of the gospel going to around the world. But as the scripture was getting into the hands of people, people saw, we have responsibility to do this, to take the gospel. Anyway, we're about done here. Our time is up. Let me summarize. Dispensationalists see information as progressive in scripture. They interpret the Bible literally in both Old and New Testaments. So they, they see hell, creation, and a future for Israel as literal. They distinguish between Israel and the church. I will build my church, Jesus said, means that church wasn't existing before then. Very important point. And they're premillennial, and pre-tribulational in their eschatology. Not all are pre-tribulational, but most dispensationalists are premillennial. That meaning that Jesus is going to return before he sets up a literal millennial reign here on earth. And I ascribe to that. And so I don't consider myself a classic dispensationalist. I'm sort of a leaky guy, but I definitely have some issues on the other side in terms of some of these distinctions that we've made. So at any rate, I hope there's been something you've gotten out of this. So let me pray, and we'll take a break, and we'll come back for our annual meeting. Father, thank you for this time. We can just look at some distinctions, and I realize, Lord, I didn't do a great job, and certainly I didn't do a thorough job on this, and forgive me for what's going on in the minds of some people. Why didn't he deal with this? Why didn't he deal with that? And I certainly, Lord, we want to be children of the truth, believing, taking your word literally, and believing Christ is going to return, living in the light of that, Lord, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, the Lord Jesus. And Lord, to the degree that I'm wrong, forgive me. And I know that it'll all get sorted out because these men of God in the Reformed movement, as well as men of God in the dispensational movement, Lord, it emphasizes and they come and go. But if we're true in our love and knowledge of Jesus, Lord, we're going to worship and get it all sorted out someday. And we look forward to that as well. In Jesus' name, amen.